Back in 1975, Chevrolet introduced what would be their most famous attempt to combat the crippling oil crisis by launching their smallest and most fuel-efficient car up to that point, the Chevette. This is a story of its rapid rise in popularity, only to become just as quickly outdated and soundly beaten by its rivals. This is the story of the Chevy Chevette. This is my old car. Launching in September of 1975 as a 76 model, the Chevette replaced the publicly scorned Vega as Chevrolet's only subcompact model. The Chevette's biggest marketing push was simply its reason for existence, fuel economy. The EPA rated it at 28 miles per gallon in the city and 40 highway, which is a selling point that many popular compact crossovers and SUVs fail to deliver even today. The fact that it weighed less than 1 ton clearly was a big factor in fuel savings, considering most cars in 1975 weighed 2 tons or more. It was also one of the cheapest, stickering as low as $2,900, which is less than $14,000 today. How many new cars today can you get for under 14 grand? Even by the end of its 12-year run, in 1987, you could buy a Chevette for only $5,000, which means, adjusting for inflation, the price of the car actually decreased. Although notably, the car's price was decreased the most in its final year, in an effort to curb a drastic decrease in sales. But of course, today's cars, even when adjusted for inflation, cost more because they contain far more convenience and safety features than the makers of the Chevette could have ever dreamed of.
You have on it!
AM radio, console, reclining bucket seats, white striped tires. It's all standard on the four-door Chevy Chevette, even the hatchback.
Airbags? No car had those yet. You want an FM radio? Extra. Air conditioning? Extra. Power brakes? Extra. A passenger side mirror? Yeah, even that was an option. An automatic transmission was also an extra cost option. Nowadays, the very few cars that still offer a manual may actually cost more than their automatic counterparts. The first Chevettes were only available as three-door hatchbacks. Starting in 1978, it was also offered as a five-door hatchback, which eventually became the more popular choice. The cheapest model, known as a scooter, came standard with no rear seat, no glove box door, no armrests, and even the passenger seat could not be adjusted. Eventually, declining sales made it clear that there was such a thing as too cheap, and the scooter was no longer available after 1983. And of course, we can't forget to mention the Chevette's horsepower, or lack of it. The Isuzu-built 1.4-liter carbureted gas engine made an anemic 52 horsepower, but if you splurge for the upgraded 1.6-liter, you got a whopping 8 additional horsepower. 0 to 60 times? Well, as my wife used to say, being a former owner of 3 Chevettes, it could do 0 to 60 in a day and a half. But I did find an old car and driver review from 1977 that said it took almost 20 seconds to do the quarter mile, ending it at only 66 miles per hour. Top speed? 81. By 1979, the horsepower ratings improved to 70 and 74 for the two engine choices. And by 1981, a 1.8-liter diesel was offered to provide better fuel economy, but not better performance, being rated at only 51 horsepower. The Chevette was built on what was globally known as the T-platform, which it shared with other cars such as the rebadged Pontiac T1000 and Acadian, Opel Kadett, Vauxhall Chevette, Isuzu Gemini, Chevy 500 pickup, and was even marketed as a GMC in South America until 1998. Although technically the Chevette really only had one generation, since the underpinnings remained basically unchanged throughout its 12-year run. Most anyone who still remembers the Chevette may think there were two generations. The 1976 through 78 models had round headlights, a slotted grille, and hood that extended down to the front bumper, and simple three-color taillights. In 1979, the hood was shortened to latch above a chrome grille with a Chevy bowtie badge and square headlamps. And in 1980, the rear was revised with a squared-off hatch and wraparound red taillights. So by 1980, the look of the Chevette had changed enough that many probably considered this the start of the second generation. By 1983, the chrome bumpers gave way to either black or color-matched plastic covers. And of course, all the way until the end, a small white wall strip on the tires. So was the Chevette a sales success? Almost 2.8 million were sold over 12 years, but over 1.2 million of those sales, almost 42%, took place in just 3 years, from 1979 to 1981. In fact, the Chevette was the best-selling small car in 1979 and 1980. However, by 1982, annual sales figures dropped by almost half. In its final model year, 1987, only around 46,000 were sold. The final car was built in December 1986, before calendar year 1987 even started. Compare that to over 450,000, its best sales year, in 1980. So what caused the decline? It didn't help that GM resisted making any serious upgrades to the car, keeping it as rear-wheel drive, despite the Ford Escort debuting with front-wheel drive in 1981. Other serious competitors, like the Toyota Corolla and Honda Civic, also had front-wheel drive. It also didn't help that by the mid-80s, GM started cannibalizing the Chevette sales by introducing new Chevy models that were designed and built by their rivals in Japan. The Spectrum from Isuzu, the Sprint from Suzuki, and later the Nova from Toyota, not to be confused with the original American-built Nova from the 70s. But maybe that was the plan, as the Chevette was originally considered a stopgap until the X-body cars, most famously, or infamously, the Chevy Citation, started production in 1979. With the sales of the Chevette climbing by 1979, GM kept it going after the Citation hit the market. Ironically, the Chevette would outlive the Citation, which died an early death in 1985, thanks to numerous confidence-killing recalls. One can also wonder who originally came up with the name Chevette. It was surely no accident that it sounded similar to Chevrolet's most famous model, the Corvette. I can only guess that someone thought, hey, the Corvette's a cool car, so they'll think the Chevette's must be cool too, right? Even more irony here, the C3 Corvettes of the late 70s are widely considered to be the worst of all Corvettes, thanks to their stupidly low engine output forced on by the same high gas prices that helped create the Chevette in the first place. One would think that with almost 2.8 million Chevettes sold, you would see more of them on the road today. Just the opposite. They are now so rare that they are almost considered collector items. Chevettes were meant to be used and thrown away, and their lack of build quality made it highly unlikely that an early model Chevette could survive even into the 1990s. I've been to more than one car show in the past few years where a Chevette was on display, and often with many onlookers reminiscing about a time long since gone. Usually these Chevettes are not in great condition, but the fact that they exist is a testament to their owner's dedication to preserve a piece of American history. Chevettes have also become popular with hot rodders and drag racing fans who upgrade them with V6 or V8 engines. As a child of the 70s and 80s, and a former owner of a 1981 Chevette, I never expected that someday the Chevette could maybe, just maybe, be considered a cool car. If you like what you saw here, don't forget to like and subscribe. This is the first video of many that I hope to make about old cars I once owned. If you used to own a car from the 80s to early 2000s that you almost never see today, and you'd like to see it showcased in a future episode, put a reply in the comments or email me at the address shown here. See you next time.